introduce Pastor Johnny Epps tonight real quick. He's celebrating 65 years of ministry. This man's a general. 65 years of ministry. And he ministered at the Lighthouse Gospel Mission when it was downtown. Amen. He knew Brother Leonard. Amen. So, amen. Let's give the Lord some praise for Pastor Johnny Epps. Amen.
Anybody happy to be in the house of the Lord? Some of you guys want to help the young people. Come on, we're going to get our young people up here. They're going to bless you a little bit. Praise God. I don't know if they brought their, I didn't see his guitar amp up here. I guess they got one. Amen. Amen. Yes. They're going to come and bless us. I was going to have my wife say a word, but she went to the ladies' room, I guess. Praise God. I'm ready tonight. Hallelujah. I got back up, and back up. So I'm ready. Doesn't matter how long it takes. I got it right here. Somebody say amen. When I started preaching at the age of 8 years old, and the Lord called me to preach at eight, I preached on John 3:16 for the first year of my ministry. I didn't know nothing else. Anyway, God bless us. We've seen many souls won to the kingdom of God. They're getting ready to sing for us tonight. They got microphones up here. You got your guitar ready and everything. You want to share? You want to come and testify and get ready? Praise God. Get the, give the, require the fire a good hand. Praise fire.
Hallelujah. We went to an event called Acquire the Fire. Everyone's ever heard of Acquire the Fire. And we got fired up. Amen. And so we decided to go with our youth group names, Courageous Youth Ministries. So we decided to go with Courageous Fire Live, amen, for the band, amen. But God is good. We're glad to be here tonight. Glad to be here with you. Enjoyed the worship. It was amazing. And we're just going to worship a little more, amen. We're going to worship a little more. Hallelujah. I'm just waiting on my guitar player over here. But I thank God he is good. His mercy endures forever, amen. Has he been merciful to you tonight? Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. We give you honor and praise in this place. Hallelujah. You are worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus. I'm trying to give him a minute. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But the keyboard's wound up over here. Let's do that one that you mentioned.
Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence. Fill us with your power. Live inside of me.
Come on, you know it. Sing it.
Welcome, Holy Spirit. We are in your presence.
Worthy, you are worthy. Hallelujah. We just came to worship God with you. And I'll tell you what, we haven't been outside of the church. We built the group and things for the youth in the church. And we hadn't been outside, so this is like our second time outside the walls of our church. So if we look a little nervous, it's all right. Are you ready, honey? If you could turn that guitar and his mic up over there, it would be great. But we're going to do this next song for you. How many know you got to have joy on the journey? Amen. And the Lord didn't mean for us to live here in the Mully Groves and to live here through these problems and not have joy, because he's the one who gives it to us. We just got to tap into it. Amen. Hallelujah. We've got to tap into it. So listen to the words. Y'all probably know it. Joy of the Lord is my strength. His peace, amen. Nothing like deliverance from the Lord, amen. Hallelujah. This next song is one of my favorites, but that last one was a favorite too. They're all good, amen. They're all good. Hallelujah. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
In our lungs, so we pour out our praise.
Jesus.
Great are you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Let's sing that one more time.
Great are you, Lord.
Give courageous fire a good hand. Praise God. They are a member, one member of the wall here with us today. Brother Joe's back there. Stand up, Brother Joe. He's one of the members. The other two members, three, are working tonight. Amen. Praise God. Glad to have. Honey, I want you, my wife, to come up right now real quickly and take just a moment. She has endured me for the last 51 years. We've been married 51 years. Praise God. She preached last night at the church, and she's been my companion, my friend, everything for MNG.
I could say maybe his worst nightmare. It's only when it's a honey-do list is it bad. Last night I preached, and I made a statement. I said, there's one thing the devil hates, and all of you, you caused him to hate tonight. Because he hates worship. He hates true worship. You know, you can, and I'm not taking away from anything. But see, Jesus, he knows when you really worship. You know, you can be worshiping on your floor at home. You don't got to be up here in the sanctuary, but you can be worshiping anywhere. Because when we worship the Lord, you just don't know all the rewards that come along with that. He restores my soul. He does so much for you. I mean, you know, when you get in the presence of the Lord just for a minute, what all it does to you. Touches your mind, your heart, your soul, your spirit. All of a sudden, there ain't a devil too big. There ain't nobody got no more problems because the Holy Ghost has done got a hold of the whole situation. And you know what? All we got to do is get in his presence. And when you learn to get in his presence and you worship, here, you better take on mine.
And she can go with it too. Amen. Praise God. Can two preachers live in the same house? Yes. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's the anointing, praise God, that keeps us together. Amen. Hallelujah. I tell you what, I want to share something with you tonight because I feel like that we're living in a day of the church. I really believe that we are in the day of the greatest opportunity for the church that ever was. We got a reprieve this year when we voted in a new president that believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on. I was so proud to hear people get up and use the name of Jesus, in the White House and all that. Let me tell you, folks, I mean, you know, it said it's not politically correct. Honey, the church has always been politically correct. Come on, say amen. And my message tonight in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, verse 18, he says to Peter, and he's talking to Peter, he said, Peter, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell cannot fail against it, prevail against it, huh? Listen, folks, we took a step back the last few years. It seemed like the church has been going through some trials and going through some situations. But I'm here to tell you tonight, we need to start taking our place in the church. We need to take our place because the Bible said even hell can't come against the church. The First Amendment or one of the amendments said there would be no laws created. Come on, against freedom of worship. Hello, I'm here to tell you, folks, we have the greatest opportunity in the next 4 years anyway to lift up the name of Jesus and tell him that we are going through. Hallelujah. All the way. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm telling you, folks, I run into a guy the other day, and he had met him at McDonald's and had a few talks a little bit. And he said, you know what the Lord has told me to do this year? And I said, what? He said, he's told me to speak to three people every day about Jesus. That don't sound like a whole lot, but there's 365 days in a year multiplied by three people. Honey, that's reaching a lot of people. Hello, for the Lord Jesus Christ. Honey, we need to let the world know the church exists. And we're here to see revival come forth. We're here to see a move of God. We're here to see people get saved and delivered and set free. January the 1st, I started a fast for 21 days. During that fast, God spoke to me, and he said, I want you to preach two special messages during this year. And I said, all right, Lord, what are they? He said, I want you to preach to the people about their salvation. I want you to stress. How many know that's the most important thing is salvation? Hello? The Bible said we'd be judged by the works that we do. Hello? We get up to heaven, we ain't having the works if we ain't winning souls to the kingdom of God. Hello? And I heard a man say here one night when I was here last Friday night, he said he talked to a fella and said this fella said he died and went to heaven, and St. Peter took him to heaven, and he said he went up there to see his mansion, but when he got there, hello, he took him over to a field full of children. Hello? All these children. He said, what's this about? He said, these are the children that died before they knew anything. Amen. They're happy. Praise God. They're rejoicing. He said, I took me up into a mountain. I like that. Took me up into a mountain, and I saw all kind of people in the mountain up there. Hello? He said, these people mostly made it in by the skin of their teeth. They just barely made it in. Hello? He said, well, where's the mansions at? He said, I'll take you over to the mansions. And he took him over to the mansions, and on them great big mansions, huge mansions, they had men like T.L. Lowry and Billy Graham, all these great men of God that sent material up by getting people saved by the hundred and by the thousand. Listen, folks, it's the whole thing about this thing we call the Holy Ghost and the move of God is how many things we can do for God. Hello? Listen, folks, I want you to know tonight, and the second thing the Lord told me to speak about, hello, I said, Lord, what do you want me to speak about? He said, I want you to tell people, point blank, that they need to put their finances in the hands of God. Hello? Amen. Did you know that they say only 30% of the church-going people pay tithes? Hello? Not here. And not my church. Hello. Come on. But many churches, the small majority of the people support the church and do anything that has to be done. Then the Lord spoke to me. He said, we was praying about what we was going to do for this new year. And the Lord said, it's time to extend your borders. It's time to reach out even for greater things. Praise God. And I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? He said, the same thing you did the first time when you built your new church. He said, I want you to get your jug. I want you to put it out there every service. And I want them to get people to give money like that, and whatever they can give, and even the pennies and nickels and dimes and quarter can cause miracles to take place. Hello. You're not going to grow, hello, financially until you put God number one. Hello. I'm not preaching on finances tonight. Hello. But I wanted to tell you, God spoke to me and said, brothers, if we don't put God first in our finances, we won't put God first in our marriage. If we don't put God first in our finances, we won't put God first in our businesses. Hello? We need to realize that when we put God first, that's where the blessing starts. We got to start somewhere. And honey, let me tell you, if you only start with giving whatever you can give, start giving something to God. Somebody told me one time, said, I give. I said, you do? He said, yeah. I said, the Bible said I'm worse than an infidel if I don't take care of my family. So he said, I pay all my bills and everything else, and then I pay tithe on what I got left. Hello? Don't work that way. I don't know about you, but first fruits don't mean last fruits. Hello? I wasn't even going to preach on that tonight. Hello? I'm talking about the church. I'm talking about we need to realize that God has got a church, a body of believers that can change entire cities, that can change entire neighborhoods. Come on, say amen, somebody. Honey, let me tell you something. Some people, let me tell you, you come to church every Sunday, but your neighbor, you don't even know whether they're saved or not. You got friends that you go out to dinner with. You got people that you work with on your job. Hello. And you've never brought up the reason to find out whether or not they're saved. Hello? It's a shame that being Christians, our job is to talk about the Lord, and sometimes it's the last thing we talk about. Amen. We should be so filled with the Spirit of God that people can just see it oozing out of your body. Hello? You should have so much of the anointing of God in you that sinners feel uncomfortable around you. Hello? Come on now. I walked up in Walmart's in the checkout line, and this man was hollering at the lady at the counter saying they went up 10 cents on my favorite beans. Raising Cain to that lady about his beans going up 10 cents. Hello. I looked at him and I said, brother, you ought to thank God you have 10 cents to buy your beans. Come on, say amen. Hallelujah. He looked at me kind of strange, and I started walking away. Praise God. And the lady behind the counter said, I perceive that you're a Christian. Hallelujah. Come on. We need to have people that know when we come around them, they'll seed that we're a child of God because we built upon this rock that God said, the Bible said Jesus is a rock that was hewed out of the mountain. Come on, somebody. We need to realize without Jesus, praise God, we're just destitute. We have nothing without him. Hello? We're living in an hour and a time, especially right now, when God can move the church like he's never moved it before. Huh? Believe big. Think big. Not in your own self. Amen. Amen. When I seen a man on a television the other day, had no arms and no legs. Hello. Preaching the gospel. Preaching the gospel. No arms, no legs. And what's your excuse? What's your excuse? If you got arms, you got legs, and you have cars, and you can go, come on, if people have to take him where he's got to go, come on, he's got to have, somebody has to take care of him every day of his life. But honey, God will make a way where there seemeth to be no way. If God can use a man that has no arms and no legs for the kingdom of God, what's the excuse of the church? We should be so hungry for the Word of God. Hello. Man, I'll tell you what. My young people have took a task of reading the Bible through in 1 year. Young people. Hello. I've read the Bible through probably 66 times in the 65 years I've been preaching. Hello. Amen. And I didn't understand some of the stuff I read. I don't understand it. Why should I read it? Huh? There's a whole lot of stuff I didn't understand at that moment. Huh? But see, as I growed in God, some of the things I read become real to me. And I started to see in the revelation that God gave the church, the revelation that God has given his people to go out and win souls to the kingdom of God, go out into the highways and then the hedges and compel them to come in. I asked the lady, I said, go by this woman, pick her hair and her kids up. They want to come to church this morning. She said, you talking about that lady? I said, yeah, that's lady. She said, I'm not going by there and pick them up for you, Pastor. I said, why? She said, I don't want them snotty, no kids in my car. So worried, hello. You get worried about things. Come on, cars come and go. Houses come and go. Jobs come and go. Doors open and doors closes. But if you're in God, hallelujah, the right doors are open, the right cars are come, the right houses are come. God will supply your need. Because he said, I'll supply your need according to my riches in Christ Jesus. Brother, I'm here to tell you that we are standing right in the place where God can just let the church see a revelation of the Holy Ghost. Come on. I probably could preach a message on the end time as good as anybody else can. Hello? But they ain't learned how to win souls yet, and they ain't ready for the end time. Hello? Come on. Tell the truth, Brother Epps. Come on. Good preaching, Brother Epps. Listen. We are commanded of the Lord to win souls to the kingdom of God. That's our job. Our job is not washing cars at a car wash. Our job is not running a machine at the office. Our job is not doing whatever you do every day to make a dollar or two to pay your bills. I'm going to say amen. Money is not something that we need to love. Come on. It's just a means to take care of whatever you have to take care of. And God will supply your need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. God said, I'll do it. Hallelujah. If the church will get into the place where God wants and start believing God big, then God will start doing big things in your life. Hello? Amen. I got a vision. I got a vision. I'm 72 years old. And I looked at my wife and she said, we was laying in the bed. And I said, when I get old, I'm going to have slowing down. She said, honey, you already there. But see, I just don't see age being a factor in the Word of God. Joshua and Caleb was up in their ages. Come on. But they said, I'm going to claim my mountain. Oh, your age has nothing to do with what you can do for God. We're the church. We're the church. We're the body of Christ. Hello? I'm sorry to say, if you don't have your heart on somebody getting saved once in a while, if you don't have one member of your family that's unsaved and you ain't been praying for them, shame on you. If you got a neighbor beside you that has parties and drinks and corrals and wakes you up sometime during the middle of the night, hello, you know what you need to do? Go over there and hit him in the head. No. You need to crawl out of your bed on your knees and get a hold of God and say, God, I don't want to hear that in my neighborhood anymore. Come on, say amen. I'm here to tell you, when you pray, angels start moving. Praise God, the heavens start moving. And people start seeing revelation. And God starts doing things for you as you walk for God. When I lived in Tampa, I lived right off 50th Street, Grant Park. The back of Grant Park was a known drug place, just totally drugs everywhere. Hello. On the way home, I'd pass through some of the road, and you see girls out there, selling their body for money. Hello. Selling drugs. You stop at a stop sign, they headed over to you to sell you some drugs. But I prayed. I said, God, we're not going to have this on my street. I rebuke the devil right now in the name of Jesus. And brother, I want you to know I lived there 21 years on that street. And 21 years, the drug addicts got arrested on my street. Everybody, everything they tried to do, God shut them down. Little old lady lived across the street from me. And she passed away. And her son got the house. I come home one day, and he looks across the fence. He said, what are you going to do about having a drug house across from yours? I said, it won't happen. Hello? He said, I'm going to fix mama's house up, and I'm going to sell drugs out of her house. I went to church one Thursday night, Praise God, one Thursday night we come home and the fire truck was all over the place. His house burnt slap to the ground. One of my members said, did you put legs on your prayers? I was in Plant City. I wasn't there when it started. Hello. But when you live for God and you ask God to put a covering around your family, to put a covering around your neighborhood, to put a covering around your family, God will do it. Hello. You don't have to be a mat for the devil. You don't have to be bow down to somebody that wants to cuss in your face. Praise God. You know? Man started cussing, and he wasn't even talking to me. He was talking to somebody else. I looked at him. I said, brother, we don't talk like that around here. He was about twice my size. You know? He said, what? What? He'd cuss so much, he didn't even know he was doing it. He said, why? What did I do? I said, we don't cuss around here. Oh, I'm sorry. Are you a preacher? I said, yeah. I'm sorry, my mama taught me better than that. I said, why ain't you doing it? A lot of us have been taught the values of the Word of God has been taught. To come to church. We've been taught to pray. We've been taught to pray for our enemies. Our enemies. We've been taught to pray for everybody around about us, but we don't do it. But that's our job. Because we're the church. Jesus said to Peter, upon this rock I build a church. He wasn't talking about Peter. The Catholic Church thought he was. He was their first pope. Catholic Church thought it was handed down. Like, we'll get Peter. When he dies, we'll bring in another one, And they've been doing that for hundreds and thousands of years, I guess. I don't know how long they've been doing it. But they've been doing it a long, long time, praise God. And they've been handing down the reins to another pope and another pope. Now, this pope here's gone radical. And they want to get him out of here now. Praise God. He said, be friendly to the homosexual, but you don't have to love what they do, but be friendly and love them and get them saved and get them changed. Hello? He didn't use the word saved, but he used changed. Hello? If he knew what saved was, whew, what a pope would he be? Hello? But listen, folks, we're in the last of the last days. I don't believe there's very much longer left. When I was 20 years old, or 19 or 20 years old, God gave me a vision, and I saw a clock, and on this clock, it said 5 minutes to midnight. 5 minutes to midnight. I said, Lord, what does this mean? He said, time is running out. Now, I don't know what a minute is to you. The Bible said a day could be 1,000 years, or 1,000 years could be one day. I don't know what it meant, but I know one thing. We're running out of time. We don't know it, but we got the answer. We've got the answer. The church. Hello. The Baptist churches. When I lived in South Carolina and I was young, we didn't have too many churches around. And the Baptist church come by and say, can we take your kids to Sunday school? Hello. And you know what made me want to go? Because when I got on the bus, they gave me a piece of candy. When I got off the bus, they gave me another piece of candy. They didn't have to tell me to be ready next Sunday. I was already ready because I knew when I got on the bus, I was going to get a piece of candy. Hello? But we won't even ask somebody to go to church by saying, the Bible says, compel them. They need to do like my brother did. My brother, my one brother was unsaved. My other brother's a pastor. He said, Johnny said, I'm going to bring Tim to church. I said, good luck. I've invited him 100 times. He said, no, I'm going to invite him to church, and after church, I'm going to take him out for a steak dinner. I said, really? I hope it works. It did. He come to church. The message was preached. The altar call was made. And Tim come walking down the aisle and gave his heart to Jesus Christ. Come on, somebody. Did he change overnight? Not really. But he gave his heart to God. And then slowly all that stuff that was inside of him started peeling off. Will the real Tim Epps stand up? Hello. Because he's been somebody else all these years. He was my alcoholic brother for 28 years. He was my brother that did anything he wanted to do and didn't think there was anything. He told me, I said, brother, why do you take your wife and the money you make and go out and spend it on beer? He said, I don't do that. He said, I take my paycheck at home and I give it to my wife. I go to the bar. There's always be somebody there that'll buy me a drink. I never spent a dime. Somebody else got him drunk. Hello? Why can't we get that way about the church? Why can't we get us a Holy Ghost feel that we bring people into church and give them what we got, that when they leave here, they got what you got, that your Holy Ghost is touching them and being saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost? Tie my bow tie. That's what one preacher told her lady. He said, if you want to speak in tongues, just say, tie my bow tie. Keep saying it. Keep saying it. And the Holy Ghost will show up. The Holy Ghost don't need nobody to tell you what to say. The Holy Ghost don't need a person to set you in a chair and say, repeat after me, and you'll get it. Hello. You might get something, but you might not get what you want. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost speaks for itself. Besides, it's not your language anyway, it's God's. You know what the Holy Ghost is for? For your soul to cry out to God. Your Holy Ghost makes, I know it has benefits like drinking. And when you get drunk, you get in the Holy Ghost, start speaking in tongues, and you feel, woo, woo, woo. Somebody asked me, I've never had touched alcohol or cigarettes, anything since I was born almost. Hello? But let me tell you something. I've got so high in God, I couldn't even walk home. I've got so high in the Holy Ghost, come on, say amen, where I fell out on the floor. I look like a drunk man walking down the street. You know what I'm talking about? And I never had a drink because the Holy Ghost hit me and filled me with the anointing of God. And you don't have to get drunk to feel that way. Honey, all you have to do is get in the house of God and get a hold of the anointing of God and the power of God and the glory of God will fill the house. Up on this rock, I build my church. What kind of church is he building? I'm trying to close. This is my first closing. Most churches build their church on the number of people they can get to show up. Hello? Some of them build their church on how much money comes in. Hello? They even put big old banners up, plaques up to tell you, oh, this is how much come in Sunday school, and this is how much come. I used to have one of them. And boards, you know, tell you how many people and how much money you took in Sunday school, how much you took in offering, how much came in that Sunday. I burned it. I threw it out or I got rid of it. Hello? When the offerings got down so low, I was ashamed of it. Hello? I didn't want my visiting preachers to come in and see you only took in $214. I said, get rid of that thing. My God blesses me. Since I got rid of that, praise God, our budgets took off their, I think people was waiting to hold their money back just to watch me look at the board. Hello. But I told them, I said, I ain't going to have the board. Hallelujah. And God has quadrupled the offerings, praise God, by not having a board. Come on, say amen. Up on this church, I build up on this rock, I build my church. What kind of rock are you? Are you a sandstone rock? One that, it's a rock that water gets on it and it just melts down to nothing? Hello? Are you a rock that over the years you've been wore down so much there ain't much left of you? Are you the rock that Jesus said, I'm going to build a church, and this church is going to be able to survive, and they're going to be there when the world's coming to an end, and we're going to see Jesus coming in the clouds of glory. Honey, I'm looking for him any day now. Every time I get up in the morning till I go to bed at night, I said, Lord, is this the day that the Lord has made? And I'm glad, and I'm rejoicing in it. Hello. I'm looking up to the eastern sky. When you get, Brother Hagee said, if you ain't looking for the coming of Christ, then you ain't going. If you ain't looking for him to come, you ain't prepared. If your lamp is running out of fuel, I've been going to church for 40 years. Or they tell me, I've been in the way for 40 years. I said, yeah, you've been in the way for 40 years. Listen, folks, we need to make a reality of this thing. Jesus Christ is coming again, and he's looking after people that are saved, born again, ready to go to heaven, that God told them to lay out on this floor for 21 days. They'd stay there until God said it was over. There was a lady, I'm trying to close. I think it's Ernest Ainsley's sister. She was an evangelist. My wife was prayed for in her meeting, and God instantly healed her. She was in Tampa, but didn't happen there. It happened in another city. She was up preaching, just Holy Ghost preaching. And one, she raised her hand out like this, like she was going to say something, and totally froze. Didn't move. Stood there. Her husband said, somebody told her husband, you better go get her and take her to the trailer. No, he said, leave her alone. For 3 days, she stood there on that platform. For 3 days, she's out, had about 100 people coming to the tent. And said, 3 days later, hello, she's out, she was still froze. People come by during the day just to see if she's still there. The whole town was talking about the lady that froze. And they was coming from all over the state to come down to see the lady that's standing on the platform not moving an inch. When she came out of it 3 days later, there was a lot of Bible about 3 days. I know. She came out of it 3 days later. She had over 1,200 people there in the tent, jam-packed people, and started up the message where she left off preaching. Hello. The power of God filled the building. People started running to the altar and giving their heart to God. They fell on their knees and asked God to come into their heart. Let me tell you, I don't believe it's going to take something like that, but I know it's going to take a move of God to shake people's hearts and lives. Up on this rock, you're the rock. Jesus is the rock. See, the word Peter means rock or stone. Listen, God wasn't telling Peter that he was going to be the head of the church. That wouldn't be what he was doing. He was telling you, keep doing the ministry I've given you. You keep preaching the word I've told you, and you'll see millions come to God. Millions come to God. Let me tell you, folks, if we don't preach the message of the coming of Christ, if we don't preach that they need to get right with God, there'll be murders on the street. There'll be people killing babies. There'll be people, come on, there'll be things going on forever as we just let it set aside and don't get up and say, declare the word of the Lord. The very last closing. Had a friend in the church named Romeo. Romeo was a great tall guy. He came here once with me. He passed away a few years ago. Brother Romeo said, the Lord told me to pray for I-4. I said, what in the world are you going to pray for? He said, there won't be no deaths on I-4. I said, that's a tall prayer. A real tall prayer. Brother Romeo started praying. And for 3 years, he prayed every day for I-4. There was accidents. There was all kinds of things. But for 3 years, there wasn't one death on I-4. One death. Not one death. The day he died, 6 people was killed in the middle of Tampa on I-4. Where they come to go, I-4 and 75 comes together. Don't you tell me that your prayer won't do something. Don't tell me you can't pray for your loved ones and God save them. Don't tell me you can't pray for your coworker and God save them. Don't tell me you can't pray for members in the church that's in halfway in and halfway out. They just in far enough to be happy, but out far enough to be miserable. God sent me here tonight, and I said, Lord, I'm going to tell them that only the blood of Jesus can cover a multitude of sins. I tell people everywhere I go, I said, the devil can't get me at all. He can't get a hold of me at all. They said, why? I said, I'm so covered with the blood of Jesus Christ. If the devil tries to come across that bloodline, he'll be one saved devil. I'm covered with the blood. Jesus' royal blood runs through my veins. And whatsoever I asked him in his name, he said, I'll be glad to do it. I'll be jumping to do it. I'll be hollering to do it because he loves you. Tonight, if somebody wants to come and play something, I want to do something real quickly, softly. I know we're in a revival center church. I love this. I had a revival center in Plant City for 4 years. We had church every night, but one night a week. I think it was Monday. It's the only night we had off. The rest of the week we were revival. Every night for 4 years. 4 years. If I couldn't get a preacher to preach, I preached. But every time a preacher come to town, some of the people that come to this revival would get saved. We seen 200 people in that little bitty store building, packed and jammed. We had a bar next door. One night this old drunk comes staggering into church. Sat down beside Sister Ward. He pulls out a cigar and she looked at him and said, we don't do that here. He said, well, I'm not going to smoke it. I'm going to chew it. He looked at her and said, you want some? He said, no. Said, this is the house of God. And you're going to respect the house of God. Or you're going to eat that cigar. Little bitty old woman. She said, I'll push that cigar so far down your throat. He got up real quickly, looked around and said, I'm in the wrong place. And he walked out. But let me tell you something, folks. There's a lot of people look saved, and they talk like they're saved. They're Sunday morning Christian or Sunday night Christian, but during the week, they're not saved. With your head bowed and your eyes closed just a moment, I know this didn't start. Altar calls didn't start to 1935. But as your eyes are closed, your mind's on the Lord. I want to ask you a question. If Jesus came before we leave this building, Can you truly raise your hand and say, I'm going to heaven? Or would you have to raise your hand and say, Brother Epps, I'm not where I know I go to church, but I know I'm not where I should be with God. Maybe I'm not totally backslid or not totally away from God like I was been before, but I know I'm not ready. You say, Brother Epps, would you pray for me? Raise that hand up. Let me see your hand. There's one. There's one. There's another one. Brother Epps, I want to be ready when Jesus comes. Let me see that hand. Yes, that little boy can raise his hand. That little girl can raise her hand. Come on. I got saved at 8. Don't despise a little child wanting to come to pray. Anybody else in this place? Is anybody over here yet? There's a couple more. There's one back there. Anybody in this middle section right here? 1, 2, 3, 4. Come on. Anybody in this section over here, raise your hand high. Raise it high. Praise God. The next thing you got to do is you got to make an open confession. That means you need to come out of your seat right now. Come and stand in front of me. Come on. Come out of you. If you raise your hand, if you saw somebody beside you raise their hand and they're not coming up here, grab them by the hand and bring them. Come on, bring them. Bring them. Coming, you know, G. Praise God. This is an old song I heard years ago. Coming home. Coming home. I'm not going to wonder anymore. I'm coming home. Anybody else? Anybody else? There were some other people. Raise your hand. You need to come. Come on. Come. There's another one here. There's another one here. God's calling you out tonight. You're going to wake up a different person in the morning. God's going to make you see glory for things that's going to start taking place. God's doing it for you. Praise God. The Bible says, confess unto me all your troubles and I'll make it well. He'll change it. That thing that's been bothering you won't be bothering you anymore. Oh, you'll wake up in the morning and the devil's going to tell you, you didn't get anything last night. But he wouldn't be telling you that if you didn't. God's talking to people. I want several Christians to come and stand behind these ladies, gentlemen. I want some of these people in their seats. Come on out here. Stand behind these people with me. I want to have a joint prayer. I want a joint prayer with these people right now. Praise God. I want you to say what I say. Say, Lord, I want to ask you to come into my heart. I want to go to heaven when I die. Forgive me of all my sins and make me whole again. Lord, I know you will, because I'm going to dedicate my life to God. I'll give it to you, God. And I'm asking you, Lord, to come into my heart and change me where I can live like you want me to live. And I can do what you want me to do, because I want to see you when you come. Lord, we thank you, Jesus. Lord, we pray for these people right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, touch her, God. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Lord, we give you praise tonight, God. Lord, touch him, God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Pastor, give me some of them red rocks out of my briefcase there just a minute. Before you go back, I want to give you something. I want to give you something. Jesus said, upon this rock, I build my church. You that are up here are going to start a new life. You're going to be a new rock for Jesus. I have 3 rocks in my pocket. The 3 rocks I have, see that? The white one, the red one for the blood. And that clear one is for streets of gold. Transparent. Transparent streets of gold. I'm going to give you a red rock. The red represents the blood. The rock represents Jesus. And you take this home with you. I've carried mine around for years. I carry it with me wherever I go. And when I have problems and I need an answer, I pull my rock out and I say, God, you're the rock. You're the rock. In the name of Jesus, God. Hallelujah. Father, I praise you for these men stepping up. God, they'll see this rock down the road. I lost my rock one time. I don't know where it went. I looked for it, couldn't find it. The Lord said, I got more rocks. God bless you. God, in the name of Jesus, thank you. Praise God. I want to take just a moment. I'm going to ask the ushers to help me. And everybody would like to have one of these red rocks. Come out and come get one. They got gifts. Give some to them. Praise God. Hallelujah. I miss him very much, but I went through surgery a few months ago, and I missed a few services, and I tell you what, you don't know what's going to happen, but God is touching Brother Furr, and everything he's going through, God knows it. He's taking care of him. Amen. Praise.
Hallelujah. Have y'all been blessed tonight? Woo! Amen. Upon this rock, Jesus built this church. Amen. Listen, and we are a part of it. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Amen. That's why you got to stay connected and in the church. Amen. And listen, you will not be defeated. Amen. Hallelujah. What we want to do is two things. We want to receive an offering. Amen. For Pastor Epps to bless his ministry. Amen. So if you need an envelope tonight, so what we're going to do, we're going to receive an offering for him, and at the same time, you can come up and get the elements for the communion table. So if you need an envelope to give into his ministry, please raise your hands, and the ushers will put an envelope in your hands. Sow your best seed, LRC. Amen. Ladies, for the communion table, can y'all come up? Amen. Ushers, you can release the people. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of him. You know, as we take the table, and we're going to be doing it every service over these next 40 days, the table represents victory. What Jesus did on Calvary was a victory for you and me. Amen. If there's any area in your life tonight where you're not seeing victory, by faith, receive it as we take these elements. If there's any area in your life that's not representing and displaying the victory that Jesus gave to you, by faith, receive it at this table tonight. Amen? Take the bread now and receive victory. Receive it right now. Amen. The cup, which represents his blood, the crimson flow. Take now of victory. Say, Lord, thank you.
Thank you.
Tonight, I have complete, absolute, and total victory. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Pastor Epps, we thank you for that word. Amen. And we're going to be in Plant City on the week of April. Start the 17th. 17th, 18th, 19th. Amen. It's all week, though. Amen. Amen. Old-fashioned tent revival. Amen. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you again, Pastor Ez, for coming out. We've been blessed. Amen. Right on 39. Amen. Real easy to get to. If you need directions, just call the office. Amen. Amen. We're going to dismiss now. Amen. We'll be back Sunday morning. Don't forget to set your clocks forward 1 hour. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. Father, we just thank you tonight for your word. Father God, we thank you for Pastor Epps. Father, we speak the blessing over him, his life, his ministry, his marriage, his children, his church, Father God. We bless them tonight in the name of Jesus, Father. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Amen. Be blessed.